Hey guys, I'm Sai, and welcome to ACE Podcast Nation. On the channel, you can find podcasts, content, and interview on all sorts of subjects. We've got podcasts on mental health, wrestling, football, serial killers, films, TV, music, pretty much got it all. And we have three new shows every week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, as well as extra content now and again when there's wrestling pay-per-views or UFC pay-per-views, and then new guests every week. So recently, we've had Brett Johns of the UFC, Paddy the Baddy Bimlet of Cage Warriors, and a few others to come in the works, as it were. And today, I'm joined for an on-the-fly podcast, no preparation. Just last minute dive on, so we'll have some fun. Could go anywhere. And I'm joined by Fightful.com managing editor, the man with the second best hair on this current podcast, and also the tallest man in wrestling journalism, Mr. Sean Ross Sapp. Welcome, buddy.
How's it going, man? Glad to be back here. Glad we can make this happen even on short notice.
Yeah, it's cool. Well, that's what I said to you the other week, because I knew, like, it's busy time of year anyway, and it's obviously it's like wrestling every single day, so you're busy. So I just said, hit me up when you're free, and we'll get something going. But unfortunately, because it's not unfortunately, it's just it could be more fun. There's no plan and no script. We'll just talk about whatever. So first thing I wanted to talk to you actually about was the change in landscape in wrestling, particularly for journalists and wrestling media, because, you know, since AEW officially launched, it's got to have been a very different time for you guys.
Somehow, throughout all of this, I have a little bit more time off than I did previously, and I'm not exactly sure how that's worked out. I shouldn't say more time off, more structure, because instead, you know, we cover boxing, MMA, wrestling. I can't count the number of times there was a Bellator event on Friday. There was a big UFC on Saturday. There was some sort of wrestling event Sunday. Then you got Raw Monday, SmackDown Tuesday. And that's back to back to back to back to back. At least now I know that I mean, we don't do post shows for NWA Power or AEW Dark or Impact. So Tuesday nights, that's kind of when I get away a little bit. Thursday nights, there's not much of anything, so I'm able to do that. And you have a few Sundays a month now that do not run pay-per-views because WWE is just running one a month as opposed to, well, sometimes they're running one a month, but they're running one on Sundays per month. It's provided a little bit more structure. Plus, quite frankly, the UFC has lost a ton of buzz over the last few months. It's about to pick back up, but it's lost a bunch of buzz, and it's looking to regain that. So I expect my schedule to get more advanced right now, but I'm kind of digging it. And Wednesdays are my favorite day of the week, and it's went from one of those days where I did listing your boy to doing like 4 hours of wrestling, two or three shows. It's nuts, but yeah, I feel there's a little bit more structure and things are spread out a little bit more.
Yeah, before they launched, I didn't know how you were even able to get it all together, get it going, because it was just non-stop wrestling events, MMA, and just constant. At least, like you say, you've got those Tuesdays and Thursdays, but then whenever you have a day off, there's always something happens anyway.
And the sad reality is AEW more or less replaced Ring of Honor. Like, we don't have anybody asking us to do Ring of Honor coverage anymore.
Yeah.
So a lot of what we covered in that regard is being replaced by AEW. Now, we didn't cover their show weekly like that. We covered it in the sense of results and on the Weekender podcast, but we didn't do live post shows. And quite frankly, ROH puts on a show every 2 or 3 months that requires a post show. It's an unusual transition. I thought that MLW or Impact would be the victims of AEW, but it's been ROH so far.
Yeah, definitely. And I think the interesting thing about that is I used to love Impact back in the day. Mm-hmm. And then they just went off a cliff and I lost all interest, and I would watch very occasionally.
I still enjoy some of their content, but yeah,
I actually enjoy, since AEW, I've watched more Impact than I have for a very long time. Yeah. Things like Sammy Callahan, Callahan and Tessa Blanchard have got me, you know, back into it. The interesting thing is, in the UK where I am, is that before AEW, Impact was the easiest wrestling to get to watch because it's on just like a normal free view channel. You don't have to pay for it. It's, you know, but everyone's got the channel, or they did. I'm not sure what it's on now. Obviously, AEW's on ITV now, which is fantastic. So, yeah, it's interesting. I mean, Ring of Honor, yeah, I'm not sure where that's going, I got to be honest. It doesn't look promising at the moment. And when you think all likelihood is that they're going to lose Marty Scurll, which, who, in my opinion, is probably their biggest star, kind of makes you think where they're going to go from there. But they used to be very good at restocking their cupboards with young and upcoming, you know, talent with a bit of buzz. But I feel like even the guys they've brought in, like Bandido and some others who are really good, like Jeff Cobb as well, I really enjoy their work. They don't seem to have been able to get that same momentum that they were able to get previously, like when they brought in Marty Scurll or others.
I thought they were going to as well. I thought this year they did pretty good getting PCO, Brody King, Roosh, and Bandido. Bandido just hasn't clicked for me in Ring of Honor. Roosh is their champion, but still not quite on that level. PCO and Brody were good additions. I think that those were pretty solid, but it's like, man, they you can't replace the guys that they lost. You can't replace the people that they lost. And let's not forget, last year, their women's division, they lost to Neil Dashwood and Deonna Purrazzo, and they have not been able to replicate that either. They've not been able to restock that cupboard either. And for all the people that they've been able to bring in, Jeff Cobb was probably the best name that they brought in last year. They still just haven't quite been able to get there where they need to be.
Yeah, I feel like the women's division, a lot of that is mismanagement of booking, and they never seemed to really get behind the women's division the same way Impact have, or, you know, WWE have, or NXT or whatever. Like, it was always felt to me, at least as a viewer, like a bit of an afterthought. And I feel like that harmed the way people interpreted, you know, the women's division within Ring of Honor, which is a shame, because at one point, like you say, they had Deonna, and they had Kerry Klein, and they've had Tennille Dashwood. They've had some really talented women, you know, signed, and they just haven't quite utilized it to the best, I don't think, the best the way they could have. And I think ultimately that's harmed the way people look at the Women of Honor division.
Yeah, it's been relegated. It's just been pushed down and down and down. And I think that Kelly Klein is good for what they had. I think that Sumi Sakai is a great worker. Maya Iwatani is a great worker. And that's it. That's all you got. Because all due respect to Amy Rose, Gabby Ortiz, Jenny Rose, Stella Gray, Angelina Love, that ain't it. I do. Mandy Leon, not it, not it. Maria Manic could be good, but they've had her under contract for 8-9 months now, and she's not wrestled yet. So
that long?
Yeah, they signed her in like late March, early April. Didn't debut her until late June. It took them so long to debut her. I thought there was like a conspiracy to feed me bad info, because I reported this back in the spring. And then in early October, her contract was up, and they forgot to re-sign her, and she was able to re-sign for more money. And I still don't think she's wrestled. I can check on that, but yeah.
That's mad. I thought she was like a fairly recent sign-in because...
I mean, fairly recent. Yeah, but I mean, the thing is, she was exclusive to them once she signed and finished up her dates. So she didn't work anywhere in June, July, August, September. When her contract lapsed, she re-upped after they let it lapse. They forgot to I can't remember what it is, renew the deal. Mm. And she was able to work it in there that she was non-exclusive. So now she's back working some indie dates too.
They've had some interesting contract scenarios with the women, obviously with the Kelly Klein stuff. which I got to say, I thought you did a really good job of the way you dealt with Joey Mercury, because he seemed as if he was very difficult to kind of, you know, get an interview with or like to speak with. You know, you could tell even by, I don't know if you saw the DM conversation which he released, which him and Brian Alvarez had.
I did. And the thing is, I even told my news team, I'm like, guys, expect my conversations with Joey Mercury to be screenshotted and put out there. I mean, the last time I spoke to Joey Mercury on the phone was the day before the Kelly Klein release came out, and he knew that the release news was going to come out because he had learned about it the day before. So he was very aggressive because he knew that that news was going to drop, and he knew that the Newsweek story was going to come out, and he couldn't tell me that, obviously. And here I was working on another story. So it was a very unique situation, and he didn't want me pursuing one story because this other story was coming out. It was an interesting situation, and I got to handle it with kid. I got to handle it carefully, obviously.
Yeah, I'm just going to ask, how difficult is that when the person who you're kind of interviewing or speaking to, and you're writing a story which you know is quite, you know, breaking news, if you like. How difficult is that when the person that you're speaking to is difficult or aggressive, but you know you've kind of got to, you know, you've got to speak to them and you've got to get that information to get your story right?
It's happened a lot with this situation in particular because you have Joey Mercury saying this. I don't want to say I've been friendly with BJ Whitmer and Kelly Klein, but I've never been not friendly. They're from my area geographically. They're from Kentucky. I met them at an MMA event years ago, so I was able to reach out to them and say, hey, can I get any confirmations? And of course, they didn't want to go on the record about a lot of this stuff because they had to handle it. Mercury, and I chalked it up to Mercury being Mercury and being volatile. But when then I found out that Kelly Klein was being fired and that he knew that, I was like, okay, that makes a lot more sense that he was upset in speaking to me because he couldn't put that news out there yet. Yeah. He wasn't able to put that out there. But then there was the TK O'Ryan situation. TK O'Ryan is a wrestler from Ring of Honor who had been dealing with a concussion. I reached out to him 2-3 weeks before the Newsweek story dropped because I wanted his response. Well, he went to Twitter and said, nobody asked me. And I was like, well, yeah, I did. He was upset because months and months and months ago, I did an interview with him. And on the title, I put shoot interview. Well, the reason I do that is for search engine optimization, because it might pop up in somebody's recommended videos if they're watching a TK O'Ryan match, or if they're watching something with Ring of Honor, or if they're watching other shoot interviews. I want that to come up. He was out of character, and that was that. But it was nothing malicious, but maybe he took it maliciously. I explained it to him. He was fine after that. We talked briefly. We were supposed to talk again, but it never ended up happening. Then there was another situation in which was really going to pull some covers for Ring of Honor. And the person gave me a lot of information, showed me emails, showed me a lot of stuff. And all of a sudden, the day before it was going to publish, the person contacted me and they said, if you run the report, I can't have my name attached to it. I don't want that anymore. And without their name attached to it, I couldn't run the report. It was that crucial to the story. Wow. So there's a lot of moving parts in situations like that. And especially when you've got multiple people in the office, you've got multiple people implicated, you've got people that are speaking up for other people. It is that was easily the messiest situation I've dealt with in that regard.
Yeah. It sounds like a bit of a nightmare, to be fair. So the interesting thing with that last part with that story with where they changed their mind, what would have happened if, you know, you'd published it a day earlier? Like,
I don't know. And I think that maybe there was some frustration on their part that I didn't do it earlier.
Ah, right, okay.
Because they sent me these emails and stuff like that, and some information was blocked out, dates, particular email addresses. Well, in that situation, I have to make sure that those are legit. I can't have somebody blacking out the name or the email address and just having, like, for example, Sean Sapp in the send line. Like, that doesn't work for me. I could write your email address underneath that. So I had to have that. And they were like, oh, you don't believe me. And I was like, well, it's not that. Whether I believe you or not, I have to see this. And I need to see some timestamps. And I need to see some information that is pertinent to this story for me to verify it. And it took me about 5 or 6 days to get the verified info. And I reached out to a person in question. And they talked to me off the record about it. They wouldn't talk to me on the record. And then the next day, the person that I was originally in contact with, who the story was about, said, hey, I don't want my name attached to this. I don't want to do it. It'd be more positive than negative. No good would come of it. So I was like, okay. And unfortunately, it's got to sit there now.
Yeah, and I'm sure around wrestling media, there's a lot of people a lot of sites would have run it anyway. And it's one of the reasons why Fightful is my place to go. Just because you like to, as a journalist should, you like to have several sources or verification of your information, because that's what a journalist should do. Like, I didn't go to journalism school or anything like that, but even I know that. And I feel like maybe some sites would have run it anyway. You know, you can tell that just by some of the articles you see around social media. And I spoke to a former BBC and ITV journalist this morning, just about the general media and, you know, and how certain large corporations don't feel trustworthy anymore in terms of what they're reporting and things like fake news. It's a really very interesting conversation. But she again said pretty much exactly what you just said. She won't run anything. She won't publish an article unless she's got at least 2 or 3 sources to verify the information, because that's what a journalist should do. So I was going to move the conversation on to kind of other journalists, but like the kind of clickbaity sites and journalists. But I think I'm going to stay away from that because I don't want to give them the.
Well, the I don't. The thing is, I don't mind that. I see what they're doing. I see a lot of stuff what they do, and there are websites like that that, to some degree, help promote what we do. But there's also some that misrepresent what we do as well. And the thing I've noticed the most is there's only a few of those left. There's not that many left anymore. And it used to be everybody did that except for 2 or 3. Yeah. Now it's the opposite. Now you've got, like, for example, I'll be quite blunt. A lot of people say that that's what WrestleTalk does. WrestleTalk was in preliminary conversations with me to bring me on in the summer. They wanted to make an effort to kind of improve their profile in that regard. Wrestling Inc. has spoken to me several times about that. And they've got people like Nick Kalsman who go out and do a lot of interviews on their own. And there's wrestlingnews.co that just hired Kelsey, who does a lot of that stuff. There's like Talk Sport, who has Alex McCarthy, who's awesome. Yeah. Even Barstool, Robbie Fox interviews wrestlers all the time. And it's really great stuff. And I'm not meaning to slight anybody. Like, Pro Wrestling Sheet has a lot of good stuff. Bell to Bells does exclusive stuff all the time. Like, that makes me happy that more people are going out and doing this. And a lot of people will say, well, won't that cut into your traffic or cut into this? Ultimately, no, because we aggregate stuff too. And the more good news that's out there and the more responsible media that's out there, the more comfortable that wrestling companies will be with wrestling media. And the more comfortable they are, the more stories that we get. I think the more the merrier in that regard. And honestly, when you got people that do the clickbaity stuff, it just makes us look a little bit better when we reach out to these people and we say, hey, we're giving you an opportunity to tell your story.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what you reached out over the last sort of year or so, you reached out to Leo Rush, you reached out to Corey Graves. I think there was another one as well where people had reported, you know, stuff Rollins, which was a bit clickbaity, Rollins, and you reached out to them. They spoke to you on the record. And I have to say, it really warmed my heart as a wrestling fan and a fan of Fightful, followed since the beginning of, you know, when you first started, when I saw you guys in Toronto, yeah, you know, backstage or whatever, or interviewing all the, you know, all the WWE stars, because that's how we want wrestling media to be, is to have access to those people the same way other sports, you know, soccer, American football, baseball, basketball, you know, all these sports have access to the teams and the players, the coaches, to do interviews and content. And ultimately, that's where we want wrestling to go, or certainly with the WWE, because I think most other companies are a bit more helpful.
They are. Most of them are. But I can tell you this, as we film this, I was at WrestleCade, and I can't tell you the number of wrestlers and companies that said, oh, we want more coverage. The coverage needs to be more plentiful. And then they ghost me when it's time to do the interview.
Is that right?
I halfway think that we got approved by the WWE stuff by accident. Because we have a studio in Toronto. And I hit them up, and I was just diligent about it. I was like, we have a studio in Toronto. I would love to have some people in studio. I had a lot of wrestlers go to bat for me. I don't call in those favors very much. When I'm asking somebody for info, I don't even call that a favor. When I ask them to go to PR and say, listen, he's not going to screw us over in that regard, that I call that a favor. And I had a lot of people that went to bat for me. But then I got a message from their local PR handler, who just handles stuff when they're in town, and they invited me to the junkets. When I was there, the main PR person that I usually deal with, maybe they weren't watching me like a hawk, but it sure felt like it. And they were watching like Big E come up and say, hey, Sean, how are you? They were watching Becky Lynch come up and say, hi, Sean, how are you? People that knew me.
Yeah.
But I don't correspond with these people. That's the thing. I've never talked to Becky Lynch about a story. I've never talked to Big E about a story. And I got the feeling that WWE didn't hate what I was doing, because I didn't ask like tough questions. I was pretty lighthearted in that sense. I'm at their junket. They're putting it on. So it's not, I'm not going to get on the interview and be like, Charlotte Flair, what do you think about Saudi Arabia? Aren't you pissed you can't wrestle there? That's not the purpose of that. If I get a one-on-one interview with her on my own time, that's what that's for. But I get the feeling that after feeding me 20 to 25 names, they didn't want me to develop 20 to 25 more sources. And I think that's probably where we are, because I did not get invited to Orlando when they did the junket for NXT the night that AEW debuted. I did not get invited to any of the 2K stuff, which is okay, because I think that's mainly gamer stuff. But I was on the press list for all the other 2K stuff. I did not get invited to anything for the SmackDown debut. And the thing is, I would have went to all three of them. I'll travel wherever the content is. But I think it might have been done on accident, to be honest with you.
That's a shame, because I thought that you guys did a great job with the content. And what I like about what you do is, and I think it's tougher than perhaps what people think, is instead of... It must be very tempting or very easy to fall into a trap of, when you're there, asking questions about the there and now, the current situation, the current storylines, the current events. But what you do is you try and get evergreen content, which you can store and keep up for months and months. And I think that's real clever. I've started to try and do that now, where I'm trying to collect a few shows for over December. So you're trying to speak to people about stuff which is a bit more general. So like this show, for instance, I'll probably keep for a couple of weeks, say for over like just before Christmas or just after. But I mean, I think you do Fightful, and you do that quite well, because you cut them up sometimes and you put them through listing your boy. It's a good use of content.
So, yeah, that's the way I look at it, is I got to maximize this stuff, because we are not a YouTube channel that has 100,000 views or 100,000 subscribers. We are not the top visited wrestling website. So if I, for example, I was in Toronto in August, I got that Matt Hardy stuff. He was not on TV. I knew he wasn't going to be on TV for a long time. I was like, okay, I'm not going to ask him about anything modern, like right now. I'm going to ask him about stuff that I can put in the can. It will be just as useful outside of the weather behind us, just as useful in 3 months when he comes back as it is right now. So I released the video, you know, maybe it gets 1,000 views, but we syndicate it on List and Your Boy, which will probably do another 10,000 views, downloads, whatever it may be across the various channels that we have. Oh, then we get two or three articles out of it. But before we get two or three articles out of it, those go up early access on FightfulSelect.com. Before they go up on FightfulSelect.com, they might be posted as news bits on FightfulSelect.com. And even then, we take that, because it's an exclusive to us, and we include that in our Fightful Wrestling Weekly column, which is just our exclusive info. So I get like four or five, maybe six uses out of every single interview. I got to maximize that stuff, because we are a very, very small team, relatively speaking. There are a lot of these wrestling websites that have 10, 11, 12 people. We're pretty much five guys running this. There's me, Carlos, Jeremy, and Rob primarily. The rest of the people are on podcasts. It's us four and David Tees running like three, four different websites at this point. So you got to maximize your content. And if you're not going to put it out immediately, don't ask things that will date the content, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's, like I say, I think it's very clever. And might I say, those four or five guys are all top guys. Really, every conversation I haven't spoken to Rob, but I've spoken to, I've obviously, Jeremy's come on the podcast. Mm-hmm. And we had a real good time. We had a real good conversation. And I speak to him quite a lot. I've spoken to Carlos on Twitter a couple of times. He's actually one of the few, which I haven't had on my show, him and Alex, are like my final two.
Oh, Carlos is great. Carlos is a really great story, because I didn't know him before Fightful. And I think he like created a podcast just to interview me about the launch of Fightful. Afterwards, he hit me up and he was like, hey, you need some help doing anything? And I was like, yeah, honestly, what are your specialties? And he said, boxing. And I was like, okay, that's my deficiency. Let's pick it up. And we're talking about a kid who is still in college at that point, working his ass off. And then I would get people in the media like reporting back to me from Barclays, and they're like, Carlos Toro, is he one of your guys? And I'm like, yeah, he is. What about him? And they're like, oh, he was great at this media scrum. He was great at this junket. While all these old white guys were in the corner, he was over there speaking Spanish to somebody, getting the story on something. He's bilingual. I'm able to offer him up as an interviewer to like MLW or Impact whenever, or AEW, say Pentagon needs some press. Well, Carlos Toro speaks Spanish and he can translate it to English and tell you the story exactly as Pentagon's telling you, not through Google Translate or anything like that. He knows boxing. He knows MMA. He knows wrestling. He can podcast. He can interview. He can edit stuff. He's very good. And not only that, I mean, I would say his deficiency early on was his complete grasp on the English language, and it's come so far in 3 years. That guy is a story. You put in the work, you're consistent, and you reap the rewards. And yeah, he's one of our full-timers now, and he's awesome.
Yeah, I really enjoy his podcasts as well. When he does the boxing, like post shows and stuff, big fan. So what was I going to say? So one of the things I was going to ask you about was, it's a subject that I begrudgingly ask you in some ways, because when I dread Thursday or Friday when the ratings come out for the Wednesday night wars and everyone goes a bit crazy. But I think there was a story this week, because AEW took a big drop. And it was the biggest gap between NXT and AEW in terms of, you know, where NXT had the more viewers. Do you think that's a one-off and it's just, you know, because of Thanksgiving and things like that? Or do you think that could potentially be linked to the actual content of the show?
Well, I thought the AEW sucked last week. I thought it was really bad. I think they need to switch a few things up. But it's hard for me to tell, because we've had a couple weeks back-to-back that are, I don't want to say outliers, but you had a lot of main roster stars on NXT 2 weeks ago. And then last week, it was the night before Thanksgiving. Anybody who, and some people were like, oh, you're partial to AEW. I don't care who wins. I do not care who wins. I hope they both do 10 million viewers next week because I want them to come watch my post show. The more people that watch each show, the better. But AEW skews younger. And here in the States, the night before Thanksgiving is the biggest party night of the year. Bar none, the biggest party night of the year. However, we are coming off of Survivor Series, but yeah, we were coming off of Survivor Series and all that, and getting a little bit more hype for NXT. They got put over pretty hard, so I don't know how that will last this week with no holiday, no presumably WWE talent. We're not coming off of Survivor Series. I think the next 2 weeks are the best way that we can tell how things will go moving forward.
Yeah, I agree actually with you with AEW for last week. I enjoyed the Chris Jericho segment at the very start of the show, although I thought it went a bit too long. And I enjoyed the John Moxley kind of thing right at the end where I liked that they didn't, you know, fully interact. It was just the stare down from a distance, just to tease it. But the majority of the stuff in the middle, I kind of could have taken or left. And that's the first time in all the AEW shows where if I had been watching on like Sky or whatever, I would have fast forwarded through some of it. So
it was bad. Some of it was just flat out bad, man.
So that's not a habit which they want to find. And what I do think is since that first week, the first week NXT went up against AEW, it felt like they were trying to counter AEW. Whereas since that second week after that, I feel like NXT has concentrated solely on what they want to do and the stories they want to tell. Hasn't been perfect, but I feel like since they focused on themselves and not AEW and not worrying about, you know, what they're doing in terms of the storytelling, I feel like their shows got better. And most weeks, I enjoy NXT more, which is really weird because I tend to watch AEW first, but each week when they're finished, I think, you guys do the podcast, you go, which one, you know, in one word, who do you think was better or what do you think was better? Yeah. And most weeks, it is NXT, generally.
Yeah.
But
that's what got on my nerves when people are like, oh, you're making excuses for AEW. I'm like, okay, well, I can tell they don't watch our show because at the end or sometimes the beginning, just to generate some conversation, I go through and I say, Alex, one word, who won? Warren, one word, who won? And all but 1 week of this entire Wednesday Night War, we have said NXT. Now, the thing is, only 1 week have we said, boy, that AEW show was bad. Yes. So that should tell you about the quality that we're getting on Wednesday nights. You know, you mentioned like AEW needing to change some things. There's more character development and story on Dark than there is their actual show. And yes, I get it. You want to give the live crowd an actual show. You don't want to show them videos the whole time. But there's got to be a way to figure that out. There's got to be a way to do that to where you can run some of the great features that you have on Dark on the main show. And a little bit of a quiet scoop that I won't put out there publicly yet, but it will be out soon. Britt Baker had to fly herself to Atlanta to film that vignette before the Bea Priestley match. She was like, it needed something. I needed something. She told Jeremy Lambert she flew herself up there.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That is crazy. But that's disappointing as well, because I do feel that, you know, it's a brand new wrestling show. You know, what is it? 7 weeks old now or 8 weeks old, something like that. In terms of, you know, from where they started their TV product, a lot of the characters are unknown to the audience. You have to develop them. And even the ones that people are familiar with, they're different to their previous iterations that people would have seen. So you have to show the audience why. And, you know, vignettes are the best way of doing it. Promos maybe need, I don't think they do enough promos outside of Jericho and Cody. I also think it's not helping that the Young Bucks keep losing. Pentagon and Phoenix have lost several times. These are your big stars, and they're losing too much for me.
People want winners. People want to watch winners.
We discussed that on the last time you were on, didn't we? That, you know, basically, like, a losing streak can work, you know?
Yeah.
But I think generally people want to support people who win and are successful. Like
if John Cena came back tomorrow and went on a losing streak, and then he was like, damn, I've been gone for a year. I came back. I can't win. Maybe I don't have it anymore. And, like, say he loses to Humberto Carrillo. That's a big-ass win for Humberto Carrillo. He shouldn't get it. He's not ready. But say you have somebody that is ready, Ricochet. There you go, Ricochet. And he's like, oh, this is an outlier. This is an outlier. But no, he keeps losing. He keeps losing. And he's like, well, maybe I don't have it anymore. And then he starts winning again. Maybe he finds a way to win the Royal Rumble, or he finds a way to win Elimination Chamber, finds a way to get there, and he becomes like almost an underdog, a celebrity underdog. There's a story to be told there. But I don't know that anybody loves 50-50. Unless you're doing like a best of seven, like the old Booker T series, sure, maybe that works. But everybody expects that to be 50-50. I want to watch winners. And unless you got Conor McGregor charisma, then you can get away with it.
And funny enough, like with the Young Bucks, is they tell me every week on commentary that they're the best tag team in the world, yet they keep losing. So if I've never seen the Young Bucks and I'm not familiar with their Ring of Honor and their New Japan work, and I don't watch Being the Elite, I'm thinking, well, that doesn't correlate with what you're telling me. There's a disconnect from the commentary. And I do think that commentary is a problem for AEW. I think JR should be just doing the main events, because I think he does more harm than good throughout the show.
The most over team in the company is probably Jurassic Express, and they're like 0-4.
Wow. That's madness.
Yeah.
Because if you think of over Luchasaurus's and Jungle Jack Perry, as JR likes to call him, you know, that's the one problem with the, you know, the wins and losses being tracked as they are, is every time they come up on screen, you have the people's favorites or people who they're trying to push, and you see how many times they've lost. And at the moment, it feels like a lot of the big names or the most over names have lost maybe a bit too much. I would have protected Pentagon and Phoenix a lot more, because I feel like they both as a tag team and single stars, top stars.
Four and four as a tag team. Pentagon is 5-6. Phoenix a little bit better, I would imagine, because he beat Nick Jackson a while back. But man.
See, my problem with that as well, sorry to interrupt you. My problem with that is that outside of the Young Bucks, there's not really another tag, maybe Private Party, who are like a young up-and-coming team. Those other tag teams, I don't feel like they should be beating Pentagon and Phoenix at this point. So you've got like Jurassic Express. Yes, they're over. I don't know if I'd want them beating the top stars yet. But I think there's a story to be told later on with them doing it. The Best Friends, whilst they're amazing workers and they're very entertaining, they're more of like that comedy team. But, you know, maybe I'm wrong with that. Maybe I'm being a bit harsh with that. The Dark Order, obviously, are being rebooted and repackaged a little bit now.
Interested in them.
Yeah, now they've repackaged them. I'm really interested in them. I thought the debut of Boris the Blade, I was going to say then. It's not Boris the Blade, that's off Men in
Black.
Butcher
and the Blade.
Butcher and the Blade. I thought that fell real flat.
Did. They debut so many people the same way. Like, if I was just watching, flipping the channel, I'd be like, what are Dark Order doing out there? That's what I would say. They're too similar to the Dark Order as far as aesthetic and all that. And Also, it does bug me a little bit that a few years ago, Silas Young was the most original looking guy in wrestling. And now there's like 100 people running around looking like Silas Young with the mustache and all that stuff. A little bit different here, but yeah. And their women's division is another issue because they've got this need, like they have to have a Japanese wrestler wrestle a match every single week in their women's division. And I feel like to some degree, it has been at the expense of the rest of the division. We don't need to see Emi Sakura out there all the time. We don't. Hikaru Shida and Riho should be the two Japanese talent they are most focused on in that regard. And they got to give you a reason to care about a lot of these other people. They signed a whole lot of people that were either green or not good for that division. And they had to make up for it in a hurry. They had to sign Shanna, Chris Stratlander, and Big Swole. And thank God they did, because they needed those three names. I just look up and down that roster and I'm like, okay, I see why you got Awesome Kong. She's got a name. She's on TV. She can't work anymore. Allie was very protected by a lot of different things. Brandy, we're not going to ever say that she's the greatest worker in the real world, but I think she's a fantastic talker. Nyla Rose, very green. She'll get there. Leva Bates, bless her, one of the nicest people. Not good. Not good. Penelope Ford still needs some work. She's green. Sadie Gibbs is going to get there. She's going to be great. But that's over half the division. Britt Baker had never worked TV regularly. She had never worked in developmental. And she's thrust into the main spot. That's tough, man. Like, you got to get some experience in there. And unfortunately for them, that's in short supply, at least as far as national television goes.
Yeah, and they've got like the likes of Sadie Gibbs, Britt Baker, those girls. They could be something special, I feel, if they are treated right and they're booked right and you hide their negatives and, you know, bring out their positives. I feel that they can be something special in the future, but they're not ready now to be the complete top main star of the women's division. And that's an issue for them. I also think it hurts them that they have one women's match per week. I know they have some on the dark as well, but like, I feel like you don't need to be formatted to one women's match a week. If the story's there, tell a couple. It just, And I don't want people to think like I'm shitting all over AEW, like for the last 20 minutes. Because I've loved AEW. Wednesday night's awesome. And I think it's an amazing time. It's an amazing time to be a wrestling fan. But there are things that I think they're not doing as well as they could. And that's only because I want them to do well. I want them to be, you know. So I can't do a wrestling podcast without talking you-know-who. Let's talk some Bray Wyatt. Come on. So, you know, I love talking to a bit of The Fiend and Bray. But actually, I'm going to start with Matt Hardy. Did you watch the Free the Delete YouTube videos he's been putting out?
Oh, every one of them. I really dig them.
Unbelievable. I only discovered them. I've only seen like the last few. But the last one he put out, the most recent, is really interesting because it's got like he's taking the water out of the Lake of Reincarnation, and you've got like the voices saying "Let me in," and you know, strong hints towards Bray, and I think his I assume it was Rebbe was playing on the piano the Bray's theme song in the background while those voices were, you know, coming from the lake. And I was thought to myself, wow, he's so creative and they are just wasting him. I feel like they could do a good little program of broken Matt Hardy versus The Fiend, even if it was like literally over the Christmas period where, you know, people are out with their family and stuff. You could do a month-long program where he comes back as broken Matt Hardy, as like this purveyor of light against evil. And I think it would get over. You could tell the story. They could have used these Free the Delete videos as vignettes to kind of slowly build it up and add to them with things like, you know, Bray went into the lake of reincarnation at the final deletion and all this kind of stuff. I just feel like Matt has got so much to give. And it's very clear from his Twitter that he wants to work with Bray Wyatt.
Yeah, everything that I've heard is that if Matt doesn't get some good creative stuff to do, he'll probably leave. And I've had a lot of people say, well, where? AEW? No, I don't know where, and I don't think he needs AEW to be creative.
No.
You want to talk about a shot in the arm for another company? Impact could use him. Ring of Honor sure as hell could use him. Just his name. And he won't have Jeff around during that period. Jeff's deal extends another year. I think they could have done that, especially over the Christmas period, as you mentioned, because they do a lot of stopgap stuff there. But I don't think they will now that he lost to Buddy Murphy, unless they have him snap. Then they might have a little bit of something. And the story's built in there. I just don't think they will.
Yeah, they. In fact, that would be perfect, wouldn't it? You could probably have him lose again on Monday to, you know, Umberto Carrillo or whoever, Ricochet, and then have him snap and do like do the broken angle, but do it kind of relatively quick. Don't drag it out for weeks and weeks. And then you could go into that with Bray. I think they've slowly, over this last week and maybe the week before, they've realized that they were just doing the same thing with the Fiend and the Firefly Funhouse. It was the same every week. It was kind of a segment, and then he would attack. It was just repeat. It was monotonous. Whereas last week, I thought it was very interesting on SmackDown. They had three different segments, which went through the show. And then you had the shearing of the hair, I guess. So I saw an interesting video on YouTube. I forget who it was. I think it was Wrestling Days, maybe. But they speculated that the very last scene of SmackDown, so you know when he was in the ring and he was ripping up all the hair, and then the very last scene, Bray goes down under the ring and then it comes up and the Fiend is there and there's the camera zooms in on his face, and they speculated that the face that they zoom in on at the end is not Bray, because it's got like female eyelashes and stuff. Obviously, mm-hmm. the rumors were Liv Morgan and stuff. And I thought one of the things which Bray has done so well with this character, particularly with the Firefly Funhouses, is he's left things to the imagination or for people to work out for themselves, the Easter eggs and the different things that he puts in the promos. You're rewarded for, if you watch Bray Wyatt from 3 years ago, you're rewarded for that by the Huskus the Pig or the, you know, the Rambling Rabbit characters, because you know why those characters are what they are. And I always like that. It's, you know, I want to be rewarded for watching every week with continuity and stuff like this. But equally, I thought, well, if that was a female at the end and it was like, and they didn't, you know, rub it in your face and say, oh my God, it's a female Fiend. Oh my God. It'd be very interesting if they did do that without saying anything. I had a look at the screenshot, and I got to say, it does look a bit like those eyelashes do look female, shall we say. But I don't think WWE could help themselves to not bring it to attention, whether it's on social media or digital or on the show itself, and say, oh, is that another Fiend or is that someone else with a Fiend mask? So, yeah, that's an interesting. Do you think Liv Morgan will go with the Fiend?
Well, she shouldn't, because that's a SmackDown thing and she's on Raw. Yeah. And it would just be them bastardizing that even more. Although they could say, and I'm still waiting for them to make sense of this, Liv Morgan, Alexa Bliss, who else? Nikki Cross. And they could say Sheamus. We're all part of that deal where SmackDown got the rights to pick Sheamus, and then they got those three other people for Brock Lesnar. I think they would beat you over the goddamn head with it. Oh my God, those are female eyelashes. Wow. That's what I think they'd do. And that's unfortunate because I love subtlety. I love subtle things, and we just never see them.
Absolutely. Okay, so for the last, we got a bit of time anyway. So who do you think is going to win the Royal Rumble for the women? Who you think they will.
So they got this tag title gimmick, right? Which keeps everybody on both shows, yada, yada. I wonder if they'll find a way to parlay that into one of three things, either a horsewoman four-way, which should main event WrestleMania, a returning Ronda Rousey, or Rhea Ripley. If you can't get Rousey, do the horsewoman. If you can't find a way to do that and make sense of it, do Rhea Ripley. Rhea Ripley's over big time. She's going to be a big star. And you could say, oh, too much too soon. No, she's made forever. She's made forever if she does that. But, I've heard people speculate that maybe Ronda and Becky is the way to go, and that's a legit big match.
Yeah, definitely. I think I would love to see Rhea Ripley versus Becky one-on-one, main event WrestleMania, or even if it doesn't go on last. I think that would be incredible. And I tend to agree with you. The only way I could see them going with Shayna to face Becky. I've got a feeling that an NXT person will win either the male or the female Rumble this year. I do think they'll go with at least one. Personally, I'd go with both, but that's just me.
Probably do that to establish that. Probably to establish, because hey, the Royal Rumble's probably going to be a lot more packed this year, but now I think that's something that they'll do. Plus, you know WWE, they never like putting the Royal Rumble winners in the actual main event anyway. Very rarely does that happen. Almost feels like almost never does it happen. But I think they'll do it, and then that person will face probably Adam Cole at WrestleMania and get their NXT title match. But they'll use it to abandon the brand split. They'll be like, oh, well, they're going to show up on Raw or SmackDown and tease the fact that they can be in it. Or that they can pick whoever they want. But, I think that it'll be an NXT name as well.
Yeah, just because it legitimizes NXT further, doesn't it, as on equal footing with Raw and SmackDown, which I think they do need to do. They do need to keep doing it for the time being, just to make sure people realize that, you know, it's on USA. It's the same as Raw and SmackDown. Who would you have win the male Rumble?
If we're going with an NXT name, I mean, Matt Riddle seems like an easy bet, but he's not the guy they're pushing real hard right now. Ciampa. Probably Ciampa, because he never lost his title. And that's an easy way to set that up. I would have Adam Cole avoid him at all costs. I would have something prevent Ciampa from getting a title shot, and then he comes back and he wins the Rumble. If you're doing an NXT name, if you're doing a name in general, who would I have? I'd probably have Braun, because I think he should be a big star. But
2 years ago, he should have been, shouldn't he?
Yeah, he should have headlined WrestleMania 2018. Can't even remember what headlined that.
Yeah, I think, I agree with you about Braun completely. When he was having that feud with Roman Reigns, was unbelievable. He was so over.
It was Lesnar and Reigns headlined that WrestleMania. Should have been Lesnar and Strowman, or Strowman versus Reigns, because Strowman versus Reigns at that point in some sort of big match would have been main event worthy, because they had a great feud before that. Instead, Braun was teaming with Nicholas. Meanwhile, they could have done Brock and Nakamura. They could have done Brock and AJ. They could have done any number of things.
And they did not. So
they didn't.
If I was doing the male Rumble, I would go with, so if it was an NXT name, I would go with Riddle, But it, like you say, it's clear they're not there with him at the moment, because just by the way they portrayed him during the Survivor Series, all the run-ins, he was kind of, I don't want to say an afterthought, but they didn't kind of focus on him. As you know, it was Keith Lee who was doing the flips over the ropes on Raw, and it was Adam Cole cutting the promos or doing the matches.
And I don't think a title match is the money match for Matt Riddle. Brock Lesnar, Brock Lesnar or Goldberg is the match, specifically Goldberg. That is the WrestleMania match to do. And if I were WWE, I would consider maybe not doing it at WrestleMania, maybe doing it at TakeOver, because imagine that crowd just eating Goldberg alive. And if Goldberg embraced it and he was a heel, ooh, that's a special moment. That's such a special moment, because Goldberg is a special kind of asshole.
Oh, yeah.
He really is. I fully believe that Goldberg thinks that he can beat up Matt Riddle in real life. I think that he thinks that.
He cannot.
And I think everybody else believes that he believes that as well. It's just that he can't. He can't.
Yeah.
He'll get hit with one liver kick and shit his pants for the duration of the match. Pardon the language.
It's okay. It's okay. I would like to see Goldberg versus Riddle. And now that you've said that, I want it on TakeOver and not WrestleMania, because that would be a special, special atmosphere. The heat, Jesus, would be unbelievable. I think in the Rumble, I'd have maybe Goldberg come in relatively late, cleaning house, just maybe him and a couple of others in the ring. Then you have Riddle come out like 28 or something, and you have to face off in the ring.
Yeah.
And then you have Riddle eliminates him, and that's what it's kind of instigate his bit, like he's bitter and he turns heel at some point between Rumble. And it's simple.
Brilliant, easy setup. Brilliant. Cool. I like it.
Yeah,
and you know, Goldberg could turn heel right then and just attack and beat the shit out of Matt Riddle.
Yeah.
And you could say he's suspended for a month or 2 months or whatever it is. Keep him off TV until you need him back on TV. You could keep Riddle off TV until you needed it. And then when Goldberg shows back up, Matt Riddle's music hits, or Goldberg can go to Full Sail. Imagine Goldberg at Full Sail.
Jesus.
The heat there. I mean, if they're trying to portray this, and because Goldberg doesn't belong to a brand.
No.
Yeah.
No, he doesn't. And the other thing as well is what you could do is what you said there is, if Goldberg's suspended, because after Riddle chucks him out, he gets back in the ring, he just eliminates Riddle, destroys him with a chair or something, you know, injures him. And then he's suspended for a month to get him off TV, get him, you know, because he does not there every week. Well, yeah, then could do is have Riddle start you could have Riddle start squashing people and counting the streak that he's on in the build up to WrestleMania, with him kind of mocking Goldberg and hitting the brainbuster and beating opponents, you know, quickly kind of taking a piss out of Goldberg basically, and his, you know, the streak he had in WCW. But you know, the stories are endless of what you could tell. But going back to my original point, if I was going to go with an NXT name, I'd probably go with Ciampa, maybe Gargano. But I think ultimately my choice for the Rumble winner for the males would be Aleister Black to go against the Fiend.
They haven't ruined him yet. They haven't ruined him yet.
No.
He hasn't lost to a bunch of people. His striking is really good. I would have him do a bevy of one-hitter quitters on people. Spinning back fists, spinning back elbows, the black mass, big knees. Just have him knock people out.
Yeah, and have it that the story is, his character, his build-up, whatever you want to say, is that he can knock his opponents out in numerous different ways. And you need to give him like a top star, as well as all the, you know, the jobbers and the mid-carders that he's going to knock out in those last few weeks before the match. You have to have him do it to someone big. I don't know who, but someone who's got that name value that really takes it up a level. But Yeah, I think I'd like to see him. I think him versus the Fiend would be special.
They do have a few people that they haven't completely marginalized yet. AOP have not been marginalized yet.
Viking Raiders.
Yet, although it was close with that weird crown jewel loss. Like,
yeah.
Just don't have them in the match. And then you could build up to the greatest tag team in the world versus the tag team champions. Like, it's... But then again, they had already beat the OC five times. So. Yeah.
They did it all a bit backwards, didn't they?
Yeah.
OC is another team which is wasted, in my opinion. as a tag team, I mean.
Sure.
So, just to finish off, what do you think, or should I say, do you think CM Punk will wrestle at WrestleMania?
I do. I do think he will.
He'll be in the Rumble?
I don't. But the funny thing is, he left WWE in part because he was scheduled to face Triple H at WrestleMania. If they face each other at WrestleMania, that is a legit main event of the show.
Can you imagine the promos? If they let him do like a shoot-style promo, be unbelievable stuff.
And Triple H's promos would be good. Yeah. Because he would come on there and say, you know, you bitch about part-timers. You bitch about all this stuff. You bitch about time off. You took all this time off. You're a part-timer. And you came back looking for a match. Just like all those people you bitched about. Meanwhile, I've been the one here every day. Even though I haven't been wrestling, I've been here every day. I've launched a new brand since you've been gone. Yeah. Like, it'd be so
beautiful,
good.
Beautiful. It will be amazing. How would you start that feud? Like, what would be your when CM Punk first appearance on WWE kind of TV? How would you begin it?
Well, it would depend on the brand because they have firmly established NXT as Triple H's brand, but he is not an NXT star. So I would maybe have him just do the old interrupt promo thing. This is a situation where it works. Triple H is out there saying something, and then Cult of Personality hits, and the place goes banana.
Yeah, that's the one thing, I suppose. Neither one of them's on any particular brand, so they could do it wherever. They are positioning the brands very interestingly at the moment, because obviously NXT is, for years now, it's been like the development brand where they're getting the up-and-coming stars ready to go to Raw and SmackDown. Whereas obviously that's changed now. And since the brand split, I look at the rosters, I look at the booking, and Raw very much feels like this brand of young wrestlers who they are preparing for years down the line. The likes of Ricochet, Carrillo, there was a couple of others which I completely gone a blank on.
But you've watched my show, you know I am not sold on Carrillo.
What I mean is from a like an age and a potential point of view, it feels like that's what they're doing with Raw.
Yeah.
And then they've added some experience. Then they've got like your AJ Styles and your Randy Orton's. And I found it very interesting because for so many years, Raw has been that flagship show. And I feel like SmackDown is very much there in their eyes, the A show. So it's interesting that what they're doing with it.
Carrillo needs to team. I mean, I don't know how many people know that him and Angel Garza are cousins, but you want to talk about a guy he could learn from. He could learn a lot from Angel Garza.
Special he is, isn't he?
Oh, Angel Garza is going to be awesome. Angel Garza should be in the spot that Carrillo is in right now. If they wanted a Hispanic young star up there to impress people, it should have been Angel Garza. But the difference is, Angel Garza is 5'9". Humberto Carrillo is 6'1". That's what I take out of it.
Absolutely. And he's just entertaining. He's good in the ring. He's got that special something. So just one last question to finish off there, mate. Do you think whenever they do the next brand, I think they'll do one on probably post-WrestleMania, will NXT be involved, fully fledged in the brand? In the draft, sorry, I said brand.
And the shakeup, whatever they do, I think so.
It's gotta be, isn't it?
I think it is. I think so, yeah. And I think this shakeup will be a bit reduced. I think it'll be fewer people because they pretty much switched half the rosters out last time.
Yeah.
Also, they bastardized it. It sucked.
Superstar shakeup.
My God.
Pile of shit that was. What I would like to see is them swap some top stars and some upper mid-card stars who have got the potential to be top stars. So, for instance, maybe if it was now, you would move Drew McIntyre to SmackDown, but not just move him and do the same stuff with him. Move him to SmackDown and push him straight into the title picture, make him go on a tear and make him a top star or a Ricochet. So like you're trying to elevate people instead of just moving them sideways to do the same thing on a different show, because that's the pointless. I think Undisputed Era goes SmackDown. I think it sounds like Ciampa's going to be staying on Raw, staying on NXT from what he said on that podcast. However, workers be working. That's all I would say.
I'll say this. The last Superstar Shakeup, they moved 45 people. That
too many.
That's pointless. It's pointless. You don't got to do that. 45 people. How about just 20? Just 15 or 20. That's it. A couple tag teams. You switch them up. A couple of women. You switch them up. Maybe three. Maybe four or five guys. That's it. Like just shake up, not completely scrambled and cracked on the wall. Like it was such a mess. It was such a mess.
And the thing is, when you move that many stars, it's not even a shake up because they end up just feuding on the other show, the same people.
So it's kind of
pointless. You've got to keep it measured and I don't know. You know, WWE.
Indeed.
So tell people, Sean, where they can find you, Fightful, Fightful Select, all that good shit.
Fightful.com, it's our main site, covers everything. Fightfulwrestling.com is where you guys want to be. You can follow us on Twitter, but FightfulSelect.com is the way to support us directly. Lots of extra shows, lots of exclusive news. It's a lot of fun.
Indeed it is. Guys, you can find me on Twitter at ACEcast_Nation. Obviously, Facebook.com/ACEcastNation as well. We will subscribe to the YouTube channel, YouTube.com/ACEpodcastNation. That's the kind of best way to support me at the moment as we keep trying to grow. We're growing all the time. The audio downloads have been amazing recently, and I can't thank you guys enough. I really am grateful. I did not expect to be hitting the kind of figures that I've been hitting with the audio downloads within less than a year. So thank you all. Thank you, Sean. And guys, look out for my unscripted, uncensored show with UFC star Brett Johns, which is going to be out at the end of this week. Well, it won't be the end of this week because it's recorded, but look out for it because it's very, very interesting and a lot of fun. Sean, thank you very much, mate. And guys, thanks for listening and watching, and we'll see you next time.